Welcome to today's program, Dialectical Behavior Therapy, Assisting Clients in Regulating Their Emotions. I'm Gary Enos, editor of Addiction Professional Magazine. Today's program is made possible by our sponsor, Foundations Recovery Network. Thank you to them and to you and our audience for giving us your time and attention. At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Beth Freimuth. Beth has studied mindfulness, mind transformation meditation, and Eastern philosophy for the past 15 years. Before joining the team at Michael's House, Beth worked as a psychotherapist and taught dialectical behavior therapy at two other treatment centers. Through her work, Beth has helped with the following populations: incarcerated women, families and children in crisis, incarcerated youth, youth and adults with substance abuse problems, adults with histories of trauma, personality disorders, and numerous other mental health issues. Beth is deeply committed to helping clients find coping skills that are effective in their lives. She strives to assist clients in lessening the suffering in their lives and increasing their experiences of joy and peace. Thank you very much, Beth, for joining us today. And with that, the audience is yours.
Thank you so much, Gary. So happy to be here with all of you this morning. Well, it's morning here in Palm Springs, California. So good afternoon to those of you in the Midwest or on the East Coast. Again, my name is Beth, and I am a dialectical behavior therapist. I work here at a dual diagnosis treatment center in Palm Springs, California. And today we're going to explore numerous different facets of dialectical behavior therapy. We're going to start with a little bit of the history, where DBT came from, what it really means, that big mouthful, dialectical behavior therapy, what the overarching themes and philosophical principles are that guide DBT and the skills that we teach within DBT. We'll be talking about the phases of treatment, the way to introduce DBT skills effectively, and then we'll be going through the four modules of DBT. So those are our four areas of study in DBT. We'll go through each one, defining them, sort of talking about the purpose and how they are useful to individuals struggling with their emotions. And then we'll explore skills with each module. So it's a lot we're going to cover. We obviously can't cover everything, but I will try to definitely give you a real flavor today for what DBT is, and then a few pointers on incorporating DBT into any clinical practice. I really believe that that is very possible, and we're going to end today with a short practice of the skills. In my opinion, it's one thing to talk about it, and it's a totally different thing to practice it. So we're going to spend the first half an hour talking about it, and then we're going to spend the last 10 minutes practicing it together. So happy to be here with you. Let's dive right in and get started. Okay. So I like to start by explaining some history of DBT. It's very important, in my opinion, to understanding the way that DBT is taught and understanding the really strong philosophy that DBT has behind it. So most of you may have heard of Dr. Marcia Linehan, the founder of DBT, a professor at the University of Washington, a research psychologist. She, in the 1970s, was a cognitive behavioral therapist, and her area of practice was working with individuals who had chronic suicide attempts, many of whom had been diagnosed with borderline personality disorder. So what she was particularly interested in was understanding why CBT was not more effective with those particular clients, particularly those with borderline personality disorder. How come she wasn't seeing significant reduction in self-harm, in impulsive, dangerous behavior? And what she found through her research, so that was the original research, was that clients who had been diagnosed borderline personality disorder and were being treated with cognitive behavioral therapy felt invalidated for the most part. They felt that they were being pushed too hard to change too quickly. So they felt there was this pressure, change how you think, change how you feel, change how you behave. And it created a disconnect between the therapist and the client, a real friction. And what she saw in her research was one of two things: either clients dropping out of therapy, not showing up, not practicing what they were being taught, or sort of giving lip service to the therapist, saying, thank you so much, it's so helpful. But then when it came to moments of crisis, the dangerous behavior was just as prominent. So the first piece, sort of the birth of DBT, was introducing this idea of validation, that before we invite clients to change and teach them new techniques, that first we sit with where they are at, and we 100% join and validate their emotion. Now, this is the important part. We join and validate the emotion, not the behavior and the response to the emotion. So that was the birth of DBT, was combining validation with cognitive behavioral therapy. Linehan, in her personal life, is also a Zen master. And she, you know, in recent years, she's spoken some about her own struggle with suicide attempts. And she had used some Zen techniques of dealing with and understanding emotion that she had found helpful in her own life. So basically, in a nutshell, that is what DBT is. She introduced into some of her research some of the Zen Buddhist skills, and she found that they were effective, particularly in this population. So DBT, on the whole, is a combination of the stress of validation of emotion, cognitive behavioral therapy, and Zen philosophy of emotion and Zen coping skills. So originally, DBT was designed for individuals with borderline personality disorder. However, in the last 10 years, there's been tons of research, and we've seen effectiveness, particularly changing dangerous impulsive behaviors. That's what we're particularly tracking in the research. Effectiveness with teens, effectiveness with individuals with substance abuse problems and co-occurring disorders, eating disorders, and of course, borderline personality disorder. Okay, so who can benefit from DBT? Many people that I meet in our field have a tendency to think that DBT is only beneficial for those with borderline personality disorder. And what I've found in my own practice and in my own personal life is that DBT is effective for anyone with an emotion dysregulation disorder. I particularly found DBT to be effective for individuals with anxiety disorders, hugely effective with individuals with substance abuse disorders. So I think it is not just for our borderline clients. And part of DBT is the therapist also practicing the skills, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes. But I think it's effective for all of us. It's something any of us having a rough day or feeling stressed out or having a lot of countertransference with a client. These are skills that any human being can use, but particularly those who are really struggling to regulate their emotions and maybe have ineffective coping skills. I have had less success with clients with narcissistic or antisocial traits, and it's something I continue to work on. It's always a goal of mine to engage and make some of the skills useful to different populations. So something still on my mind. Okay, so let's move forward. Make sure we have time to get through the information. Okay, so starting off, I sort of like to define what is dialectical behavior therapy, sort of the traditional DBT, as opposed to DBT-informed therapy. When you talk about a traditional DBT model, what you're referring to is not just the philosophy, not just the skills, but a set protocol. And this is for a few different reasons. There is a pretty strict protocol that goes along with DBT. And as you can imagine, treating individuals with borderline personality disorder who have dangerous impulsive behaviors, treating those individuals on an outpatient basis, there needs to be quite a bit of structure for everyone involved, for the client's safety, for the therapist's sanity, for everybody involved. So basically, the traditional DBT model is an outpatient model, and the client signs up for anywhere between 6 months to 2 years, depending on the population. With teens, sometimes the length of stay is more like 6 months. And the clients have a once-a-week skills training group, which has two skills trainers, so DBT therapists who introduce skills. And that skills training group starts off with a mindfulness exercise. Then they move into a review of homework from last week. A skill is presented, and then a homework assignment is given. And then those individuals also have a DBT therapist that they meet with once a week. And in that once-a-week session, it's less of a typical process session and more focused on encouraging the client to utilize the skills, looking at if the client is or is not utilizing the skills that they are learning, and the effectiveness. So there's many other parameters that go with this, and we could do a 3-day training on that. So I'm gonna leave it right there. If you want more information on that, I direct you to Linehan's books or to her seminars, because there is a lot that goes to a really traditional DBT model. What I do here in a residential, short-term residential program at Michael's house is DBT-informed therapy. And that's what we're going to be talking about in terms of including DBT into your private practice or your community mental health center or wherever it is that you work. I do believe that DBT can be included without the full traditional model. And actually, in the last few years, Linehan herself did some research to see if doing just the skills group without all of the traditional model of DBT, is it effective for clients in terms of changing those dangerous, impulsive behaviors? And she's found that it is effective. So we're going to be talking about ways to do that today. DBT skills can also be taught in individual sessions. If any of you today work by yourself or not in the group setting, that is definitely a way that you can introduce skills in a similar fashion. Okay, so let's get down to the nitty-gritty, to the philosophy. What is DBT? DBT, the word dialectical, it comes from a Greek word, dialectic. And it means two seemingly opposing concepts can coexist without eliminating each other. So my dialectic for this morning was that my children bring me huge amounts of joy in my life. And at 4 o'clock this morning, when my baby woke up screaming, I was not feeling the joy. That's a dialectic. One is not more true than the other. I love my children. They bring me joy. And at 4 a.m., he was driving me crazy. This is a way that our clients can learn to let go of black and white thinking, sort of take off the blinders that we have a tendency sometimes to wear, where we look at white life from one perspective and we get kind of stuck in it, and it makes us more miserable. So one of the dialectics that's probably the biggest for the clients that I work with is, I want to be sober and I feel like using. And they're both true. And we can acknowledge both of them. And it's really a way to start encouraging clients to stop repressing pain or ignoring pain, to learn how to stop obsessing on the negative, and to look at things from different perspectives, to be more open to looking at life in a different way, and to sort of being comfortable with those gray areas, with inconsistencies, and that all of life contains dialectics. Certainly every relationship contains dialectics, and most of our experience on the whole. So I'd like to move now to talking about wise mind, which in my opinion is the core of DBT. There is no DBT without mindfulness, which we'll talk about in a moment. There is definitely no DBT without wise mind. And really, the skills that you learn in DBT are all about learning how to get to our wise mind. So let's take a few moments and talk about this. This is really important. Okay. So Linehan defines each human being, everybody, as having three states of mind: emotion mind, wise mind, and reasonable mind. Emotion mind is that state of being where we are so completely overwhelmed by our emotions that we are basically out of touch with reality. We're not reasonable, we're not wise, and we let emotions drive the bus. So what is an example of that that most of us could relate to? I would venture to say all of us, but you know, I can't speak for everybody. Think of a time when you were madly, passionately, lustfully into somebody. And think of knowing deep in your heart that it was not a good idea, knowing that logically probably wasn't the best choice, everybody told you it wasn't a good choice, yet you wanted to do it anyway. That is emotion mind. We all have that state of mind. It's not just for people with borderline personality disorder, although they may be in emotion mind more of the time and make more decisions from emotion mind. But emotion mind is that place of us, inside of each one of us, where the emotion is so strong that we forget our values, we forget what makes sense, we forget what it is we're aiming for in our lives and what's important, and we just act on that impulse. This is why people shoot each other on the highway. This is why we say nasty, hateful remarks to our loved ones in a heated moment. It's emotion mind. It's the emotion takes over, and we say or do things based purely on that emotion. Now, reasonable mind is the state inside each one of us that is purely logic-based. It's like, what are the ingredients to make spaghetti sauce? I'm going to put each of them in. There's no emotion involved. It's just logic-based. It's like, what time did I have to set my alarm clock this morning so I'd be ready on time? It's, what's the code to my voicemail. There's no emotion, it's just logic. Wise mind is a place where we can acknowledge our emotions, be reasonable and logical, and come from a place underneath all of that where we make our decision. It's the place of wisdom inside each one of us. So this was explained to me by a really brilliant professor that I had as being like the clear blue sky, like our Palm Springs sky here today. Blue sky, the sun is shining, very little clouds. Emotion mind is like having a huge blizzard, like a whiteout. And it really looks like the sun does not exist anymore. But it's still there underneath. When we're in the midst of a blizzard, we just want to make it go away. We just want to survive through it. And the idea of DBT is not that we eliminate emotion mind, because remember, this is about being human. The idea is we're working to live here less often, but even more important than that, we're learning to identify when we are in emotion mind. Oops, my slide. There we go. I'm sorry. To identify when we are in emotion mind and not make decisions. So sort of like pressing the pause button, learning how to distract and self-soothe when we are in emotion mind so that we can make decisions when we get to this wise place. And for many of the clients that I've worked with over the years, it's about learning how to get there, because a lot of clients that I work with in early recovery feel like their emotion mind is who they are and that they can't trust themselves. And this is about teaching them they can trust themselves, but they can't trust themselves when they're in that highly emotional, overwhelmed state. So all of the skills of DBT are about digging out of emotion mind and getting to a place of wise mind. It's important to understand that wise mind is not always a place of peace. You know, sometimes it is. But sometimes it's just recognizing that I feel like making this nasty remark, I feel like using, I feel like running away from that job, but it's really not a good idea. For my life, that's not the best decision for me. I won't be proud of myself if I behave that way. That is an example of coming from the wise mind. Okay. So we'll spend a few more minutes talking about philosophy. All of these are core concepts that push the skills, that need to be introduced as as part of the teaching technique of teaching skills. Okay, so non-judgmental stance. This is about teaching clients how to let go of judging every moment of their lives, who's good and who's bad, and what's right and what's wrong, and what's a good Christian and a bad Christian. That's one that comes up in my group quite a bit. So it's learning instead how to look at what works and what doesn't work. Letting go of the shoulds and what we're entitled to and all of those things that sort of agitate us and cause any one of us and many of our clients to live a very unhappy life beating their head against the wall. This is about working with the life that we have and making choices that bring us moment by moment one step closer to what it is we want for ourselves. So sobriety or a good relationship or a dream of going back to school or freedom from the court system, whatever it is, to let go of the judging and instead embrace the idea of effectiveness. What works for me, what helps me in my life, and what does not. This next idea, acceptance and change, this again, this goes back to the original research on DBT. We want to encourage clients, teach them how to change problematic behaviors, and at the same time, we're helping them to accept who they are and accept life as it is on its terms. So it's sort of the balancing act, acceptance of painful emotion. That's something all of us as human beings who are alive on this planet are going to experience. And at the same time, the way we respond to our emotions will determine how miserable we are and how often and paralyzing we experience pain. Okay. And then the last piece here is creating a life worth living. Any DBT book, any DBT seminar will talk about this concept. DBT is about more than just reducing problematic behaviors. It's also about assisting our clients in experiencing peace and joy and love and connection with others. Finding something to fight for. Why is it worth it to give up using, to change my life, to challenge my patterns? Those are all really hard things to do. So we have to have some reasons why, something to make life worth living for. And it's really important for us to work to identify that with our clients. Okay. So the DBT therapist, just a few minutes on this. Again, DBT is not just about the clients utilizing the skills. In order to teach the skills, it is required that we ourselves, as the treatment provider, practice the skills ourselves. And that's for a few reasons. I mean, the first reason is dealing with difficult client population, our own personal stuff going on. It's a way to keep us healthy, to help us not be so burnt out ourselves. And it also is about coming from a place of real compassion and getting less frustrated with the clients. As we talk about some of these DBT skills, they're pretty simple. On paper, they seem pretty easy. If we truly challenge ourselves to use them when we're fighting with our partner or when we're having really tough money problems or when we are feeling immense shame or anxiety or sadness, that's when we will see how hard it is, even for all of us, to utilize the skills. So that's a really important piece of the relationship between the DBT therapist and the client, is coming from that place of compassionate understanding that this is not an easy decision to use these skills. And it's really the DBT therapist's job to help the client to see that the skills will, in fact, be useful in their lives. Defining the DBT therapist, one of the things that the DBT therapist is supposed to convey is something called radical genuineness, that there's sort of an open banter, and that does not mean no boundaries. It just means if we're doing something to cover our butts and in terms of paperwork or some interaction we have with the client, that we're open about it and that this is part of the relationship building between the therapist and the client. The therapist shares some of their own experience as they teach the skills about utilizing the skill in their own life. And it's really about the DBT therapist asking themselves, what is an example from my own life that I'm comfortable sharing about how I struggled to use the skill but did in fact use the skill, and to share that example. Okay. All of DBT goes back to assisting the client in getting the life that it is that they are aiming towards. So the client defining their own goal, and then we as the therapist giving them the skills to get to their goal. And in my opinion, using motivational interviewing technique is really the only way to teach DBT. Okay, so let's spend the next 10 minutes or so going through the actual four modules of DBT. So those are the four areas of study. And we start with mindfulness. Mindfulness is the string that ties all of DBT together. Again, there is no DBT without mindfulness. So mindfulness, in the most basic definition, is bringing our attention to the present moment. And that can be done in many, many different ways. I've had some clients ask me, well, what if the current moment is really awful? And we will talk about that as well. Doesn't, you know, every moment is not always the most wonderful moment, and we'll talk about how to work with clients on that issue. But the purpose why we practice mindfulness, and particularly in DBT, there are three main reasons that we use mindfulness in DBT. The first is to assist clients in getting to know their own emotions, and particularly to identifying what their emotions are and the actions they take in relationship in response to their emotions. So for clients, for example, to identify that social anxiety, what it feels like in their body, what their response is to it. So for example, a lot of clients that I work with have social phobia and have used in the past to decrease that horrible tension and fear and overwhelmingly awful feeling around other people. So really identifying and understanding the relationship between emotion and action. So that's the first piece. And it's a big focus on really understanding emotions within our body. The second is to learn how to cultivate and experience moments of peace and joy and relaxation and happiness. A lot of the clients that we work with in DBT have very little experience of peace and joy and fun and relaxation in their lives. And it really is about teaching them that happiness is not this destination that we get to and that lasts, but it's something that can be available to us in any moment, in any tiny little moment, by what we focus on and allowing ourselves to stay with the experience. So it's about teaching them how to do that and how to increase that experience over time by practicing. And then the third reason is to learn how to distract, to get out of that obsessive mind, that sort of chipmunk running and running and running that can happen inside of any of our heads. I've found it particularly useful for a lot of my clients when they have really intense urges to use, have urges to be violent, and it's basically learning how to distract with our minds when we are in an emotional crisis. And it really requires a lot of practice before the crisis hits. We can't start when the crisis hits. Okay. So some of the ways that I teach clients mindfulness through exercises in group or in individual coaching sessions is to teach clients how to observe the sensation of emotion inside their body. And we're going to practice that in a few minutes here this morning, so I'm not going to spend too much time talking about that. Focusing on the breath, going outside with clients and having them observe every color, every shape, noticing the tiny bit of wind brushing against their arm, or the sunshine touching their toes. Those are also ways to practice mindfulness. And then we will also practice today all of my clients' favorite way to practice mindfulness, and that's mindfulness with music. And I think in my opinion, that's a really great place to start with people who have a really hard time sitting with their pain, who really struggle not wanting to practice mindfulness, which is a pretty common experience that I've had. Okay, so some ways that you can incorporate mindfulness into any practice is to begin a session or a group with a brief mindfulness exercise. And I encourage people to start really small. Start with 60 seconds. Start with 2 minutes. For some of our clients, that's going to feel like a year. And I'll reassure them, it's only 2 minutes. It may feel like a year, but I promise you it is just 2 minutes of your life. It can be really hard in the beginning, particularly with our clients who do obsess or who have intense anxiety that can come up for them, and that's a very normal experience. Also, teaching clients how to work with the really painful, overwhelming emotions when they have it. And this is a little bit more advanced skill. So this is someone who has detoxed, maybe has a little bit of sober time. Some clients can take to this right away. I've had some who really use this, you know, their second week in treatment, and other clients contact me 6 months after they left and said, "I that really annoyed me and pissed me off when I was working with you on it, but now I'm kind of getting it." So we'll practice that a little bit today also. Also, assigning homework for clients to be practicing mindfulness every single day, even 30 to 60 seconds of mindfulness as they sip their coffee, as they take a few breaths, as they hear music in the car or watch their child smile. Those are ways to start introducing the idea of practicing mindfulness. Okay, so our second module, interpersonal effectiveness, is pretty much your basic communication skills, focusing on speaking from the I, speaking about our feelings, not attacking. But there are two sort of focuses in interpersonal effectiveness that are slightly different from some other forms of direct communication. The first is the stress on maintaining and repairing relationships. And again, it goes back to that original study group of individuals diagnosed with borderline personality disorder who have a really hard time maintaining relationships, and they are therefore missing out on one of the biggest sources of happiness in life and satisfaction is long-term connections, close relationships, caring and loving exchange. And so we teach them in DBT how to maintain and repair relationships, and we practice this quite a bit. The stress, again, it comes back to validation, to sitting with someone else's experience and letting the other person know we see what it's like to be in their shoes. And I found that to be very effective for a lot of my clients who are struggling with damaged relationships when they come into treatment. It's a big focus for a lot of them, and they found it much more effective than apologizing or making promises for the future. And the last piece with interpersonal effectiveness that I want to touch on is increasing self-respect in every moment. The idea is any interaction we have, we are telling other people how we feel about ourselves and how they can treat us. So it's about clients identifying their values and learning to stick to their values even with the most challenging individuals. Sort of them learning, again, back to mindfulness, them learning do they have a tendency to let people walk all over them, build up resentment and then use? Do they have a tendency to go off on people and damage relationships? Really for them to understand how they violate their own values, how they go against their own goals in terms of communication and then changing those patterns. So I have some here for you that you could go back to. I just want to get through this and make sure we have time to practice. So, okay. So the next section, emotion regulation. I'm going to read you a short quote here from one of my favorite authors, Thich Nhat Hanh. And in my opinion, this sort of encapsulates what emotion regulation is. And I read this to my clients. Okay, here it is. In our consciousness, there are many negative seeds and also many positive seeds. The practice is to avoid watering the negative seeds and to identify and water the positive seeds every day. And that's really what emotion regulation is. It's on a daily basis, learning how to deal with depression or anxiety or shame, when we feel it, how to not let it grow into an emotional crisis, how to address it, how to plan for it and know what to do when it's there. How on a regular daily basis can we practice increasing experiences of peace and joy and connection with others? So that's what emotion regulation is about. A big focus can be normalizing painful emotions and teaching clients how not to panic when they feel pain. And that's a big way that they can learn to free themselves of the overwhelming misery. We'll practice a little bit today of riding the wave of emotion, which is an emotion regulation skill. Okay, and then our last module of DBT is distress tolerance. And this is about surviving a really intense emotional crisis. This is about clients who've had their heart broken by the love of their life in early recovery, and all they want to do is use. And this is about teaching them other skills to keep their head above water, to not drown, to not go back to those old ways that do help them get through the crisis, but actually sow the seeds of their future misery. So that's really what distress tolerance is about. It comes back to that idea of emotion mind. When we're in emotion mind, that is not when we problem solve. We just have a plan to distract and self-soothe. We ride out the storm, and then once the storm is over, that is when we can look at making decisions for ourselves and problem solving. Okay. So some ways, I gave you a list here of some of the distress tolerance skills to practice, and it's really about presenting enough skills in distress tolerance for the clients to identify one to two ways that they can escape that really painful, obsessive mind kind of place. And one of the things I found most effective is to use really intense sensation holding of ice, and it is such a strong sensation that it can pull the client's mind away from their trouble that they cannot get their mind off of. Creating a crisis survival plan ahead of time with specific skills that they have practiced when they are not in crisis is really key. And this could be for not relapsing or other things, not raging, not being violent, not cutting. There's many ways that you can use this. Okay, so I'd like to move now into practicing the skills. You'll see now up on your screen we have five skills that we're going to briefly practice in the next 10 minutes here. I have this list up here. But what I would like you to do is to push the list aside for now. I'm going to put up this new screen. And what I would like you to do is to take the next few minutes to really practice these, remembering that if we're introducing these to our clients, that we ourselves have to practice in our own life. So the next 10 minutes is about you stepping out of your professional self, you taking a step away from the PowerPoint and the presentation and maybe note-taking. And I'm even going to ask you to turn your cell phones over so you don't see your texts or emails coming in. And to take a few minutes to be willing to practice the skills. This will deepen all of our compassion for how the clients feel when we're asking them to practice skills. Sometimes we don't feel like it. That's just human. So let's start off by taking a few deep breaths, maybe doing a little bit of stretching, and either closing your eyes or finding a spot in the room to focus on. So if you want, you can look at these lily pads, or you could look at the pictures on your desk of your family, or just stare down at the carpet. Now, for many of my clients like to close their eyes because they find when their eyes are open, it's too easy to sort of look around the room and get distracted and not focus on the exercise. So I'll leave it up to you, what works best for you. But I like to start off with asking yourself, what are the kinds of things that are on my mind today that are weighing on me, that make it hard for me to be truly present right now? We're all on this webinar together. But most of us have so much going on in our lives that we're sort of lost in our own thoughts. What I'd like you to do right now is to try to visualize yourself with a really heavy backpack, like one of those big trekkers backpacks, hiking packs. And see if you can feel how heavy the load is that you're carrying around with you. Imagine that all the stuff that's weighing on you is inside that pack. Does it feel like you can barely stand up with that pack today? Is your back killing you because it's so overwhelming, that load? Does it feel a little lighter today? See if you can feel it. And what I'd like you to do is to unzip that pack. Really see if you can stay focused on the visualization. This will be easier for some people than for others. I struggle with the visualization, but I still try. Many of my clients are very, very gifted at it. And this makes the exercise much more effective if you engage your imagination and your visualization piece as well. So see if you can visualize yourself with that really heavy pack on. You're unzipping it, and I want you to just label what are the things that are on your mind that take you away from being truly present today. And just label relationship stuff or money stuff, work annoyance, or anger, or exhaustion, sore throat, whatever it is, just label them. And then I'd like you to zip that pack back up, slowly take it off, and then visualize yourself opening the door to your office or whatever room you're in, setting that pack outside the door, shutting the door, and genuinely pushing away all that stuff that has been occupying your thoughts, overwhelming you, and sitting on you. And see if you can feel any sense of lightness from taking a break on purpose from all that stuff. Just like we need sleep to think and function, we need a break from all of the stuff on our mind so that we can think clearly and we can keep moving forward and keep fighting the fight that life can sometimes be. So now what I would like you to do, now that you've taken a break and you've brought your full attention, all of the focus that you have, onto your physical body, and I'd like you to scan your body and identify where in your body are you holding stress right now? Every human who is alive has some emotional stress, and we hold it in our bodies. Our emotions are actually sensations within the body. So I want you to be observing this for yourself. We really can't explain this to clients unless we really know what it feels like for ourselves. I would say 80 to 90% of people that I work with experience their emotions in the chest or in the stomach. So what I want you to do, let go of what the emotion is or why it's there. Let go of problem solving, how to get rid of it, and instead turn your focus to observing and describing the actual sensation. So heaviness in the chest or pit of the stomach feeling. Maybe tension in the hands. For me, I hold all my emotional stress in the back of my neck, the upper part of my back. I could just touch that area and see how tense I am. And I'd like you to go to your gut right now and ask yourself the question, if a one is the most peaceful and wonderful I've ever felt in my life, and a 10 is the closest to my edge, the most overwhelmed and in emotional pain I've ever felt, identify your number right now. And rather than asking yourself how you can improve it, if that number is kind of high, and rather than holding onto it with a death grip, if your number is kind of low, how can we make it last forever, I want you to take a step back and just acknowledge what it is. Our emotions are like clouds in the sky. They come and they go if we allow them to. So just notice what it is. Be gentle and kind and just keep moving forward with this exercise. Know what your number is. Know what it feels like in your body. And right now, what I'm going to ask you to do is to throw your complete attention into listening to some music. Now, for this part, listening to music is a little bit different than music mindfulness. Music mindfulness means your attention is like a spotlight, and you shine that complete spotlight on not just hearing the music, but truly being with the music. So you notice the words, the lyrics, and you notice the sound of his voice and the instruments. And in particular, you notice if by throwing 100% of your attention onto the music, you notice if any sensation, warmth or heaviness or tingling, anything, comes up in your body. You don't try to control it, but you allow yourself to respond in the moment to the music rather than staying stuck with your number. Okay, so I'm going to put the music on now. And I want you to let go of the idea of trying to get rid of thoughts. Thoughts will still be there. They're in the background. You just don't crane your neck around to look at them. You let them flow like twigs going downstream in a river. And instead, you put your complete focus on just being with the music.
Sometimes I let under the moon, I thank God I'm breathing. And I pray, don't take me soon, 'cause I am here for a reason. Sometimes in my tears I drown, but I never let it get me down. So when negativity is around, I know someday it'll all turn around, because
Okay, so now what I would like you to do, again, continue to stay out of your head. First observe, were you able to have even one moment where you lost yourself in the music and you lost all your troubles and your thoughts and you were just with the music? Did you have even a moment like that? Just notice that. And now go to the sensation in your body. By focusing on the music, something outside of your own experience, did your number change? Did the sensation in your body change? Just observe it. And one big focus that we have in DBT is to embrace and hold on to an experience if it is useful, if it's effective in our lives. So if your number went down a little bit, or you were able to have like a moment of relief or peacefulness, hold on to that. Enjoy it. Really notice the sensation in your body and savor it. And if not, if your mind couldn't stay focused or you didn't like the music or, you know, so much is going on for you that your mind was all over the place, then just observe that compassionately, gently, and just turn away from the experience. Most of what we're working on in mindfulness is to gently observe our experience rather than being overwhelmed by it. So I've really enjoyed going through all of this with you. We are going to have a few minutes for questions in just a moment. I have some references here if you'd like those, and the information on the song if you'd like that, my email address, and I lead a daily discussion group on DBT for Michael's House. Feel free to join that. I welcome any of you. And we also have some handouts that I've uploaded that I use with my clients, so make sure you get those. And if you would like further handouts, I have tons. I'd be happy to share with anyone. Or if you think of a question next week or next month, feel free to contact me. There's also some information about me you can go back and read later. But let's move on to the last few minutes for some questions.
Beth, thank you very much for a very informative presentation. And we have had a few questions that have come in from the audience. We'll spend the last few minutes getting in as many as we can. And if someone still has a question and would like to submit that, you can still use the Q&A feature on the left-hand side of your screen to submit a question. Beth, one of our participants asked, is it effective to use only elements of DBT when doing a brief intervention?
Yes, that can be effective to use elements of DBT. I think one thing that is important is if we are using a DBT-informed kind of therapy, we're not in a DBT team practicing the traditional model of DBT, that we inform clients and referents about this, that we use some DBT techniques and we follow some DBT philosophy. But I definitely believe that you could start just incorporating a little mindfulness or one or two of the distress tolerance or emotion regulation skills, and you could let them know that those are DBT skills without using the entire technique. It's a great question. Thank you.
Great. Another question, Beth. What kind of mindfulness do you recommend to use for a person who experiences strong anxiety?
Okay, great question, and this has been my life's work for the last like 8 years, is really exploring that, because I would say most of my clients struggle with really intense anxiety, not just a little bit of anxiety, but paralyzing anxiety that's really fueled their substance abuse. So I start off with very, very short mindfulness exercises, and I start not with mindfulness of the emotion, but I start more with external mindfulness is how I refer to it. So mindfulness with nature, sitting outside, sometimes here when it's really hot in Palm Springs, having clients put their feet into the pool and putting all their attention on feeling that sensation. I sometimes use meditation beads and have them focus on the sensation within their hand. Breathing mindfulness is such a fantastic technique. I usually don't start with it because sitting in silence with their thoughts can be very overwhelming. So music is a really good way, in my opinion, to start. Throw themselves into the music. learning how to focus on just one thing that's happening in the moment rather than responding to their really strong emotion. I've had some success with that, and clients being willing then to move forward with breathing mindfulness and mindfulness of emotion later.
Very good. We had a couple of questions, Beth, related to certification. A couple of people wanted to know, is a certification required to practice DBT? And if so, what kind of training should be pursued there?
Great question. This is going to be changing, I believe, in the next few years. There is no current certification, sort of like diploma that you get. Dr. Marsha Linehan has an institute, Behavioral Tech, and it is online, and you can sign up for trainings there. She does 10-day intensives, shorter intensives, teaching, you know, all of the very specific DBT techniques and protocol, and then there's shorter seminars as well. I recently went to one on updates, what's the latest research on what's effective for emotion regulation. So you can do any of that. It's not a specific certification program, but I believe the University of Minnesota is currently working on one, so that may change in the future. There are a number of organizations that have 2- and 3-day intensives that I found very effective. So I definitely recommend Behavioral Tech, and also PESI has some that I found really good and creative in their use with DBT.
Great. And Beth, we have time for a couple more questions. A couple of participants asked about the age range for which DBT would work best, and someone also asked about whether it does work for, is it effective for young people, adolescents, et cetera.
Adolescents are some of the individuals through research that have shown the most effectiveness with DBT. And I think it's partly related to the fact that they are not as entrenched in their patterns as we are as adults, but also because there is sort of a motivational interviewing style to it, which is appealing to teenagers, that we're identifying their goals and helping them get to their goals. So I think that this is a really great technique in particular for teenagers. And actually, I worked in a facility for teen boys who were incarcerated, and they were the ones who taught me to start mindfulness with music, that was the way that they could do it. So I found a lot of success with it with teenagers, and the research definitely supports that. We are also seeing some children using DBT, and definitely the practice of mindfulness can be introduced. Some of the more complex skills have to be sort of changed a little bit. And I actually have a former client who's coming in this week to see me for me to help her work on how to teach, she's an elementary school teacher, how to teach her students some mindfulness practice.
Well, Beth, thank you very much. I think we'll wrap up, and again, want to thank you for your presentation. We have just a few announcements to finish today. For more information about upcoming addiction professional webinars, be sure to visit us at www.addictionpro.com and click the webinars link. Also, feel free to join our online communities on Facebook and LinkedIn to share and participate in the discussion with the addiction professional community. We have some final notes regarding CE credit. Those who have viewed today's presentation as individuals and want to obtain CE credit, stay online and logged in. A link will appear on your screen in a few moments that will allow you to generate your CE certificate for this event. For those viewing as a group who want to obtain CE credit, please note that anyone who is registered will receive a follow-up email today after the event that will provide a link to verify your registration information and the event CE code to generate your certificate. Should you have any questions regarding CE certificates, please contact the CE Help Desk at the number listed here. Also, this program will be archived for 1 year for your convenience and for sharing with colleagues. Within the next few days, you will receive an email with a link that will allow you to download the presentation slides and view a recording of today's event. Again, I want to thank Beth Freimuth for taking the time to speak with us today, and to Foundations Recovery Network for making today's program possible. Finally, thank you to everyone in our audience for participating. We hope you'll join us in the future for another Addiction Professional webinar. This concludes today's presentation.